it is a huge honor for me to be interviewing, seriously, one of my idols and role models and legends in practice management consulting for, I've known you for what, 25, 28 years? Easy. And Rhonda Mullins is a dental consultant in Atlanta, and she's worked with very, very high-end people. Her clientele, probably don't want me to tell her names because it might make John Quaice mad or anything like that, but but she does. She's you're a who's who consultant in the dentistry. You're very high end. A lot of elite AACD members, speakers at the Hinman meeting. And you have an interesting story, Rhonda. She was actually consulting in your office, small town Tennessee.
Yes.
And she came in there, and you thought, "What could this woman from Atlanta teach me?"
Right.
And when it was all done and said, you actually now work with her years later. And you were originally from Knoxville, Tennessee, home of one of the idols in dentistry, John McSpadden. And I don't know if you guys are old enough to remember the McSpadden instrument, because a lot of our podcast people are young kids. But the whole space of engine-driven nitai really started with John McSpadden. Because of a necessity, he's a huge man, and my hand could about fit in his palm, and he couldn't hold those files in the back of his mouth. So there he was in Knoxville, Tennessee, total mathematician. I mean, he can walk up to the board, and one of the things he explains to me is that he starts this lecture with how dumb barbells are, because they go from 5 pounds to 10 pounds to 15 pounds, and 5 to 10 is 100% jump. Mm. And that's what we do with endofiles. So the first file to the second file is like twice as big. And he's like, they should each go up an increment. And he's explaining this geometry on a chalkboard to about 20 dentists in his home. And we're just looking at each other like, you know, like you'd almost need LSD to figure out, you know, to figure out what the hell he's talking about. One of the smartest men. So great to know a hygienist from Knoxville, Tennessee.
Thanks for
Rhonda,
me.
Thanks for coming and sharing your thoughts. Let's start with this. You and I have been in this industry for 3 decades. 3 decades ago, when I got out of school, Orthodontic Centers of America was on the New York Stock Exchange. All the orthodontists said, you know, they were all going to be working for the chain, the man. And then that whole thing exploded, disappeared, gone. 10 years, there's nothing. And now they're back. Mm-hmm. Are they back for good? What do you think about where dentistry is from when you got into it 30 years ago?
Well, I started out as a dental lab tech. I was Pankey and Dawson trained, and I was a lab owner by the time I was 25. So I had 4 technicians, did my thing. I used to host a lot of educational platforms when blade implants came to the table. You know, just the whole mecca of how the industry's changed. From there, I went into consulting, speaking, practice management. Then I went into brokering on a national level with a big company out of Atlanta. And then I sort of carved out my own space. I thought, you know, how do you serve this customer in such a way that it's not just about success, but about significance? And what sets that entrepreneurial mind and that person apart from the pack? So I had this journey of, you know, the last 20 years on my own. And 3 years ago, because of the industry shift and the landscape shift of corporate, which is coming around for the, you know, umpteenth time, but it's very successful. It's making a huge headway, and they are their own type. There is a audience for that service, but I have chosen to take the dental entrepreneur that really has elevated themselves from a clinical standpoint and said, okay, so how can you serve that customer without compromising or doing volume? And so I created Dentalpreneur Solutions, which is a strategy company, very innovative ideas, creative ideas for doctors, almost like you, Howard, that's like, you know, what can I bring different to the industry that's going to influence the next generation, that's going to keep some integrity of what we're about, how we got this far, and develop that. So I have Kim, who's my hygiene consultant. I have 2 other administrative consultants that work with me. And our approach is very comprehensive. So I look at their aptitude clinically, and I even completed 2 years ago the COIS curriculum as a technician, all 9 modules. So it allows me to identify with that type of delivery of care and better assist the entrepreneur and the clinician you know, depending on what level and platform they want to grow to. So it's been very exciting. I've never done anything like anybody else, so why start now? But it's all really about how you can impact somebody else and serve somebody else in a greater capacity. So that's really my mantra. I mean, I wrote my vision at 25 years old. The theme was to serve others. I think I've done it fairly well. I love what I do. I love this industry. And the entrepreneurial mindset today is that there's a blue ocean. There's the solo dentist, there's the emerging large group, and then there's the DSOs corporate. And I believe the blue ocean, the opportunity, the innovative, creative space, is that solo dentist that loves what they do, but they want to do it in on a greater level. And the emerging large group doesn't necessarily mean it's multiple locations. It can be under one roof. I mean, I've had 8 dentists in one facility, 18 treatment rooms. I merged 2 of their offices into one. We built a brand new facility. You know, that's the kind of area that this particular practice needed to serve, and they're doing it very well. First 4 months, that case study was an increase of 29% net. So basically, it's efficiency, it's effectiveness, and it's these dentists, male and female, that really want to engage in a greater level. You know, they don't just want to be the victims and or the reaction to what the industry is doing. They want to be proactive. And so I created this model. I love it. We're all over the country. We have the opportunity to share what we've known and how we know it. Because I brokered and I, you know, was that part of developing what we in the industry at the time called transition management. So you prep the office for transition, the transition takes place, the acquisition itself, and then you're in there after the acquisition to basically bridge the new ownership in there. And that was groundbreaking. That was in 1990 when I was with the largest brokerage firm in the country.
AFCO, mm-hmm. Which stands for Alan F. Thornburg.
Yes. Yes. And I learned a lot from that gentleman, I have
to
say.
Everyone knows AFCO, but they don't know what stands for. Alan
F. Thornburg. He really is like the godfather of transition. And since then, you know,
Spadden started the Indo file.
Yeah, absolutely. We're talking about forerunners here. I mean, that's basically it. So, you know, give back, learn what you know. And really, the way acquisitions, I just experienced an event in New York for one day. And it was strictly the top 30 DSOs in the country. A law firm out of Boston hosts this every year. And mergers and acquisitions are still going to be the running horse in the race. There's a lot of big people that are in this space, but there's room for many more if dentists choose to put on that hat and be that entrepreneurial dentist.
I want to stop and ask you about mergers and acquisitions. If you follow the Fortune 500, I mean, there are always mergers and acquisitions. Mm-hmm. And when I look at some of the biggest practices that are million, 2 million, 3 million, 4 million, it seems like if someone is retiring or dies within 5 miles of their office, they're always buying practices and mergers and acquisitions. And it seems like maybe I'm wrong on this, but it seems like 99% of the mergers and acquisitions dentistry go to like 1%. And the other 99% never see it as a strategy. Like you'll go in there and say, okay, there's 8 dentists in this building and the guy 6 doors down is for sale and he's 72 and he's blind. Why are you not buying that practice? Why are you going to have some strange kid from another county come in and set up next year? So talk about mergers and acquisitions. Is that a viable strategy?
It's interesting. Mr. Fontana, who started Aspen Dental, is currently CEO. He did a survey of the audience the day we were all at that event. And De Novo, which is a startup, they only do De Novo. That's all they do. They don't do any mergers or acquisitions. But yet the audience poll showed that 71% of future conglomerates and emerging large group strategies, strategists will be acquiring offices still. And I think that's sort of the threatening part of the solo dentist in the industry. It's like, are we going to be eaten up I mean, really? Not necessarily. There's parts of this country, and I have to say this boldly, that a solo dentist is very successful. They serve that community, they serve their people, and they are very, very welcomed. And that's apart from the big corporate. So I think when a dentist is in that category that you just mentioned, right now the thought is, why don't we merge him in here? Why don't we ask her or him to join us and or acquire those patients to serve those patients? Young dentist, I had a graduate from University of Kentucky. He said, I want to start a multi-location model right out of dental school. My brother's in financial, so we think we can do this. I said, what part of the country would you like to do it? That's key. I think like real estate, location, location, location. And they're really looking at what's available. I mean, I do that for clients that want to acquire offices. And you have to know not just the business. Like you always shared, I was reading franchise, you know, manuals when I was in high school to learn the business part. And that's the part that sets, I believe, sets me apart, is that I have the opportunity to coach and to really facilitate those deals because of the knowledge in the background. You know, they don't need a broker to talk to them. They don't need another consultant. I'm able to look at the big picture and say, here's what's good, here's what's questionable, and here's what you need to consider if you're going to consider this. And that's the investment, but how are you going to retire the debt? You know, it's easy to buy something, but what's the plan of action to move forward? A lot of the 500 offices, there's 500 emerging large groups in this country as of last week at that seminar that I went to.
500 emerging large groups? Mm-hmm. And what would be the definition of an emerging large group?
Dentist-owned, self-funded, partnerships of dentists. They have not gone to the private equity investors to have them be a part of it. The ADSO, which I'm sure you're familiar with, has opened up that part of their organization to embrace these emerging entrepreneurs and saying, you know, here's what's ahead in the industry. You're the up and coming. That's the blue ocean. It can be very profitable. It can be very manageable. And what I've experienced is, not just location management, but revenue management. So if you have 1 to 5 offices, you can handle that with a management consultant. You don't need to bring on a COO or any big, you know, payroll or anything like that. So you just have to know the model. You have to know your plan if you're going to engage in that level.
Can I have you all see my red flags? Because one of the most exciting things about being half a century old is you're not seeing any pitches for the same time. I have some players that are on the Arizona Diamondbacks, and one of them hit one of the greatest runs when they were in the World Series. And I said, you know, what are you thinking about that pitch? He goes, dude, I've been looking at pitches since I was 5 years old. He goes, I can tell in a split second what this pitch is, where it's gonna be. Yep. So when you're 53 years old, you know, you same old, same old. So again, I'll start off with what I started. You know, I come out of school. Lazarus out of New Orleans has got the Orthodontic Centers of America. There's a half dozen on NASDAQ. They all crumble. 10 years are gone. Now venture capital, the people are back. And here's my red flags. The first red flags that the cookie was crumbling is none of those corporations could keep any of their doctors.
That's right.
I mean, the minute when you work for Orthodontic Centers of America, they said you had to work here this long, and on that day at 12 o'clock, you can walk. They all walked. Yeah. Then they ran.
Yeah. Yeah.
I see the same thing. Some of these corporate chains, and if you mention my name, they'll sue you. They can't even keep their average doctor for 1 year. Okay, so that's red flag number one. But red flag number two, which you taught me about 25 years ago and I still see, is capacity. So if a hygienist works 40 hours a week, even though we've never found one that works 40 hours a week.
No.
I mean, that, so no. We're okay. Let's just say there's 4 of them. They each work one day.
Yeah.
But a 40-hour week hygienist, 50 weeks a year, is 2,000 hours a year. Mm-hmm. So she can see 1,000 people twice a year. Mm-hmm. So when I've been out here 28 years, it seems like this dentist, no one changes their capacity. So this dentist comes out and he has just one hygienist 2 days a week. 30 years later, he has a hygienist 2 days a week. This one over here had a full-time hygienist. 30 years later, full-time hygienist. Yeah. This one over here built up a two-hygiene practice. 30 years later, it's still two hyenas. And this one over here built up three. 30 years later, it's still three. So you build this capacity. So every month, for every time you shove a new patient in the front door, someone falls off the back door. So let's say Dental Wally World sets up across the street. I don't give a shit. Every new patient that walks in there, an old one's going to walk right out the back door. Nobody has been able to keep a patient happy. Dentistry hurts. It can look funny. There's insurance. I did the dentistry, but you didn't like my receptionist. You didn't like me, right. But you love my assistant. I mean, it's so damn complicated. I've never seen anybody anywhere keep all their patients. Where if you got 25 new patients a month, every 33 months, you'd add another full-time hygienist. Right. Name someone who's my age that's got 10 hygienists servicing all the people he met.
Nobody.
So I don't care who you are. You ain't going to keep any of your patients. Mm-mm. And anytime a new one walks in the front door, another someone else will go in the back door. And if you would slow down on the CAD cam and the occlusion and the lasers and focus on the soft stuff, how do you get a hygienist like you that can talk? How do you get an office manager, business consultant that actually knows? And whenever you talk about that to them, oh, is this going to be like some bullshit soft stuff? Touchy-feely lecture. I want to know how to bone graft. What file do you use? And every question they ask, like they go to Gordon Christian like he's God. And they're like, this is the composite wears at 15 microns a year. Who gives a shit? That's not your problem. Your fillings aren't wearing down. He'll say, well, if you tin plate gold, the tin oxide will bond to Panavia. I don't give a shit. My gold fillings aren't falling out. Tell me this. Why did your last 10 families leave? I don't know, but I tin plate all my gold onlays.
That's where the rubber meets the road. You know, it's value proposition. It's sort of like the minute you get a patient, is the first day you begin to lose them.
Yeah.
Think about it.
Yep.
Whenever you restore their tooth, it's just a controlled failure.
It's the first day you begin to lose them. So you have to say, okay, what is it that's going to be, how can we focus on generating value instead of, well, basically positioning ourselves with value instead of generating income? The generating the income is the outcome of the people relationship part. And whether it's touchy,
generating the income is the outcome of what?
Of the value part. I mean,
the relationship.
You have to create the value, rendering the value versus generating the outcome. And that's where we all get confused. You know, we're a healthcare provider arena. We're in this industry. It's going to hell in a handbasket, healthcare. It's scary what's coming down all around us. So the beauty of dentistry
when you make a statement like that, what's scaring you about healthcare?
Well, it's the overall whole medical, dental, the whole big picture.
And the whole big picture is I want to smoke, drink, be fat. And then when I get cancer, I want my neighbor's taxes to pay for my treatment at the Mayo Clinic. I want to spend no time taking care of myself. That's I want to
exactly
eat
right.
Twinkies
yep.
and
yep.
cigarettes.
That's exactly
and then
right.
when I die, all the rich people right. should get me an MRI
That's
at
right.
Mayo. So the rest yes. of civilization, you're either going to have efficient dictators like you see in China and Singapore,
yes.
which I think are the two best, fastest growing societies, or you're going to have all this bullshit democracy where everybody shows up and says, I don't want to pay any taxes and I want the best for free.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And so to blame that on Obama or Romney or a politician
right.
or whatever,
right.
I blame it on the American people
oh, yeah.
in every democracy. No one wants to work. No one wants to pay taxes. But God dang, they want a free Mercedes-Benz when they want a car.
And that's the part, you know,
they deserve
that
it because they were born.
I mean, you know, it's educational to look at a business like a business. And whether you want to say dentistry is a business or not, everything's a business, no matter what we do. But education, right now in healthcare, education and knowledge are two parallel arenas that we are trying to digest, which is huge. Education and knowledge, which is technology, basically.
Okay.
So the CEO of Cleveland Clinic, he says it very well. He says that, you know, we're trying to digest that. We're trying to digest HR. And that's something dentistry has never really developed the skill sets. And I have to say that that's something that we really dial in on. I mean, hygienist, administrative assistance. It's like,
well,
don't
we,
complain
we all,
if you don't develop the skill set of your people.
So, Rhonda, you're the neutral one here. Who's crazier, the dentist or the hygienist? Who is it?
Okay, I'm neutral.
Well, I mean,
I'll say the hygienist.
HR will always be impossible because when you got 7 billion talking monkeys trapped on a flying rock around the sun once a year, I mean, I don't care if you're talking about religion, politics, your family, your office. I mean, talking monkeys are crazy. And that's all we are. We're all a bunch of talking monkeys.
Well, we are.
To play nice.
That's true.
I mean, I had a lady spend 2 hours on the phone with my office manager arguing about the fee, the insurance, everything. And when she found out basically she was going to have to give us a dollar, she hung up and wrote us a negative Yelp review.
Of course.
I mean, so I spend 2 hours, I pay someone 2 hours on the phone, and what is my reward? A negative Yelp review.
Okay, so you know what that tells me? That was not a customer of yours.
Yeah, go tell Yelp that. I mean.
And
I
you
mean,
can't remove it either.
So HR, and the other thing of HR, remember this, there's not a single team that ever won the Super Bowl that next year won it again.
Right.
Because they average about 25% turnover from injuries and all that stuff. And you have 25% turnover in a Super Bowl team, and you might not even make the playoffs.
No, and the average retention of HR in dentistry is only 24 to 36 months today. That's it. So you can expect there's going to be a shifting and changing.
Yeah.
And really...
Let me ask you a question where if I asked it would be sexist. And so I don't want to go there, so I'll let you. But some people say that, you know, when all the dental graduates were men and they all had stay-at-home wives, you know, at the end of World War II, the average woman had 5.1 children.
Yes.
Now 27% of women don't even have one child. So now we've gone from dental school that's all men who had a wife making 5 babies to now half the class is women. And a lot of people say that what's driving corporate is a lot of these women just want a job because they got a husband who has a job and they got kids. The other thing driving corporate is what drove it in medicine is when they started coming out with million-dollar MRI machines. You can't have one doctor buy $1 million MRI. And that it's the CBCT and the CERAC CAD-CAM and the laser. It's all the high-tech stuff, which is driving corporate, because if you're going to buy a $150,000 CAD cam from Serona Dentsply, you're going to have to split it with 2 people or 3 or 4. So do you think, so I'm asking two women, do you think changing from all men to half women creates a foundation for corporate because there's now more people who just want a job, or do you think that's not true at all?
Well, I think all meaningful change comes from within an individual, an industry, a corporation, organization. This is just the way life is. And I believe that the mixture is going to be very positive. And women are 55% of the graduating classes now. We're at 55% almost.
But are they more likely to be an employer or an owner? Or do you think,
they're more likely. Let me say there's a small segment that are very innovative and creative. And they are serving, you know, as entrepreneurs, large groups, multi-locations. I met a woman last year in New York from Texas. She has a huge group practice, and I think there's 5 locations. She's serving that population because there's such a need. And I believe that companies like Aspen, who are giving women an opportunity to have quality of life as well as a career, in launching their Lead Like a Girl segment and putting them in offices and giving them that opportunity, mentoring them, coaching them, that they're cultivating that. And you know,
a program called Lead Like a Girl. Who runs that?
They launched it last year, and they felt like it's an opportunity for new grads to come.
Who's in charge of that program? Is it a girl or is it a guy?
I don't know, Howard, and I'm not. I really don't know.
It reminds me of the ADA convention. They always have the annual Young Dental Convention, where the youngest speaker is wearing a denture and a toupee and has gray hair. It's like, can't one of the young dental speakers at least
actually
be under under 60 and not have a partial?
It's sort of like that.
So I just assumed that, knowing dentistry, Aspen Dental, the director of the Women Lead program, is a man.
As an old man.
Well, and generationally, you know, if you had a daughter, your daughter more than likely might have wanted to go become a dentist. And so now here she is following your footsteps. And yet she's saying, you know, Dad, I still want to get married. I still want to have children, but I'm brilliant. I still want to serve like you've served in this capacity. I still want to go, you know, and do mission work, whatever it is. So, you know, looking at that quality of life and balance, a lot of husbands and wives are dentists where they split their time. I have a lot of two females that do one day overlap that share everything in their practices as far as partners. So, you know, they're sharp. Women are sharp. And I think they're a complement to the industry, first of all. The diversity is huge. And I think that it serves a population that had a need. And a lot of patients want to see a woman.
You know what I am? Yes. You know what I actually think on the, I think whenever I see an article written on the changing face of dentistry from all men to all women, I think the, I think that is a rounding error. I think the much bigger issue is the intellectual people, I think, are seeing that there's four different ways people think. I mean, the senior citizens think very different than the baby boomers, than the millennials, than the Generation I. And I don't think you should divide dentistry on gender.
That's right.
I think you should divide. I mean, there are some generation gaps between how a young dentist is working for a baby boomer.
Oh, yeah.
And a lot of the baby boomers are saying the same things, because the baby boomers, people like me, I mean, I've worked 12 hours a day, 7 days a week since I was 10. And if you want a day off, the first thing I think is, are you just lazy? Or, you know, I'm thinking, were you born lazy? Or what made you lazy? And I think people that are under 30 look at me and say, it ain't worth it. You see it in Japan. You see it in Japan where these kids are watching their parents say, man, he worked his butt off to get into the best high school, then the best college, then he got a job at Honda, and he worked 12-hour days, 7 days a week, and then he died of a heart attack at 60. And their kids are like, you can have Honda. Mm-hmm. I don't want to, that's not my life. And I think a lot of, I think my four boys, they even tell me all the time, like, Dad, have you ever thought about just like taking the day off? You know, we could go camping. And I'm like, camping? How could I do email in a tent? I can't. How would you do your email in a tent? You know what I mean?
Well, you know, Howard, I've had some life experiences, and I think life experiences really shape us. I married my husband 16 years ago, and I've been widowed 7 years, and he died a very young man. He had leukemia. He died at 57, and I remember thinking, he's so young. He had been in our industry, served in a lot of capacities, and I thought, okay, he worked so hard all the time. He gave, but was he really fulfilled? And now this is what's been handed to him. So when you have that experience, you think, okay, time's very valuable. When it comes down to life period, it's like, who loves you and who do you love? So if it's people in your industry, your family, your children, it's all about making that contribution so there's value. And then hopefully they pick the baton up and they make a greater contribution. And that's what it really is about. So when you say, my father was Italian, I mean, I know how to work. Trust me. It was like, either you work or you're dead. Because I'll kill you if you don't get in here and do it.
You know, as a child, the only time I ever saw my dad and all my memories of my dad was when I went to his restaurant.
Yes.
I mean, he was there when I woke up. He was there when I went to sleep. And I didn't know anything was wrong with that because... And I thought I was the luckiest guy in the world because when I got to visit my dad, I got to eat hamburgers, cheeseburgers, chili dogs, french fries, mulled shakes. I take my friends. They all thought they won the lottery. I was the most popular kid in St. Patrick's, you know, elementary school, because if I was your friend, you got free cheeseburgers and chocolate shakes. And I only know my dad.
Mine.
I don't ever remember throwing a football or a baseball or going to a park or anything. Yeah. We just worked and
you know it. If you can change anything in your life, what would you change? And
mine would be Ryan, my son Ryan. I'd switch him out.
Aww.
And but
he's adorable.
He is adorable.
Luckily, my four boys all had a good-looking mother.
That was that's okay.
That was their salvation. But
oh, that's a compliment, Ryan. So, you know, I look at dentistry like that. I always say to my clients, dentistry is what you do. It's not who you are. The fact that you have this passion and this drive to develop something, the why is always the driver. Why do you want to develop a practice that's bigger than you? Why do you want to give other dentists an opportunity? Most of them love to mentor. They love to teach. They love to care for their patients. And that's all about the heart. That's all about, this is why I wanted to go to school. And you have that trait too. You go to Honduras, you serve in a greater capacity many times throughout the year. You influence your children, you take them. I think that's what it's all about. You never know what that influence is going to do to another human being.
I go to foreign countries to work on mm-hmm. poor people, but the most important program is every year, February's Children's Dental Health Month, where you go into the second grade classes and teach them how to brush and floss. And I think that's the most important, because when you're in there and you're lecturing to second graders, you know somewhere in there is your next wife. And you're just trying to find her.
That may be a dentist. She just may be a dentist.
So what are you two doing now? I mean, tell them what your website is and what you two are doing now. I mean, so you're talking to about 7,000 dentists. Most of them are individual. It's all a multitasking behavior. They're all listening to you on their iPhone, Bluetooth through their car. Tell them your name, your website, and what you and your hygienist friend
Kim.
Actually do. And Kim lives in Scottsdale, Arizona, mm-hmm. up the street from me.
Yep.
But you also are licensed in
California.
San Diego, right?
Yes,
California.
I work in the summers. I get
because
out of
your husband has a business there?
He has both his businesses.
And Ryan
there.
And I, we all said last week, me and all the boys, we all went to San Diego for the weekend. We said we gotta figure out how to live in Phoenix
well,
in the
that's
winter.
How you do it.
And San Diego in the summer.
You could work from
so
anywhere,
I'm asking
Howard.
Now on live TV, can me and my four boys move in with you in San Diego?
Well, our house in San Diego is quite small, so you're more than welcome to move in. I don't know if there will be room for all of
and
us.
Can we
and my
bring
dog,
our two cats?
I have a dog, which she may get along with your cats. I don't know.
So what's your website and what do you do?
Well, the website is Dentrepreneur Solutions.
I love that name, Dentrepreneur.
Dentrepreneur Solutions. And we're a platform.
What is that called? What is that a portman do? What is it when you take two words?
Come on, Ryan.
It's like a portmanteau when you
combination word.
I don't know.
Combination word. Dentrepreneur.
Dentrepreneur solution.
Dentrepreneur. Spell it.
Dentrepreneur.
Yeah.
It's entrepreneur with a D in front of it.
Absolutely. That's okay. Entrepreneur with a D in front. I love it. Mm-hmm. And what do you? If I went to that website, what do you do? What do you two do?
Well, my team. We approach it in a team concept. Every practice that calls us. Not everybody's my customer. I usually attract the dentist that has a huge conflict. I'm definitely a solution for that.
Lots
you
of conflict
referred me
resolution.
One in California.
And what is the conflict usually? HR?
Well, it's usually between two dentists. Maybe it wasn't structured correctly in the beginning. Maybe there was no structure at all. And
in the partnership?
Mm-hmm. And there's no clarity of roles. There's no clarity of best practice standards, patient care delivery. They're not on the same page with even the types of dentistry they're delivering. You know, there's such
one wants to buy a CAD/CAM, the other one doesn't. Yeah. One wants a CBC. But what I understand is this. You get married to a woman, you have great sex and children and cats, and half the time that fails. And then they go marry another male dentist, and they have no prenuptial agreement, and they don't have any of the social glues of, well, we sleep together, we have babies, we celebrate all that. You have no social glues holding you together. Who would marry a male dentist? I mean, if I had a group practice,
not
which
me.
I do, I own 100% of it, and everyone's an employee.
Right, right.
I'm not going to marry anyone unless they're really hot.
Right.
Or rich.
And partnerships really don't work in this world. In dentistry, partnerships very rarely work. It's a huge challenge. So that's sort of what we look at first. We look at the doctors and the relationship. If one doctor, great. I mean, I work with a lot of solo offices. I have a solo practice. She has been a client of mine for 30 years. I took her from day one, $250,000 a year. We migrated the way she wanted to migrate, the plan and the model that she wanted. She's ready to retire. She loves the way she practices. And when she's done, she'll leave. I mean, that really works for most people. She was married to a dentist, an orthodontist, but they never practiced together. They had two separate entities. And
she's
I've
an awesome dentist, by the way.
Yeah,
I worked for her.
She is.
I figured out what you're talking about.
So what we do is we are a platform that lets people get things done. I look at things from a four perspective: clinical aptitude, managerial challenges, financial outcome, and transition strategies, if any. That doesn't mean, transition doesn't mean you're going to buy something and merge it in. Transition is, here's where we're at. I get people from point A to point B ASAP. That's why all my case studies are 4 months. What's the impact? We pay for ourselves in 4 months. And that is measurable, because after that, you've created a sustainable model.
But here's what you're fighting, though. All my friends who do 1, 2, 3, 4 million a year and take home, you know, half a million a year, they all use consultants, and they all, in their brain, in my brain, we know, if I give you a dollar January 1 by December 31st, I'm going to get it back and then some more. And we use them, and you just nudge us up even a little better. And some of the greatest products I've ever known, like Jerome Smith, he'll have a consultant every year. Mm-hmm. And then the other guys who just would just, I mean, you could help my practice a little. Mm-hmm. You could double half the practices in America in 4 months, and they'll never give you a dime for a consultant. So what I'm saying along the way is that everybody that desperately needs a dental consultant will never get one. And all the people who use dental consultants just use it just to round it up just a little higher and higher and higher. Do you believe that, or do you see that?
I believe that because of their mindset. Those dentists that make those decisions want to control how they do incremental increases, thinking that they have to compromise something to do that, which you don't. This is about efficiency, effectiveness, and really fine-tuning and reinvesting in your own business. This is not an investment in a consultant.
Here's what I believe is the counterintuitive. So much of success counterintuitive. Here's what I believe the counterintuitive success and that most consultants don't get. Most consultants believe in dentistry that if I go on there and show you what I'm going to do on my website or make an online CE course on Dental Town, I tell you everything I'm going to do, then you're not going to want me, you're not going to buy me, you're going to do it yourself. And it's exactly the opposite. The dentist says, I'm not going to bring her in here because I don't know what she's going to do. What if she's going to tell me I have to be a cosmetic dentist and drop all my PPO? I don't know what she's going to do, so I'm not going to have her. And then I go tell a consultant, well, you should do an online CE. I mean, you should do like your whole program. And then everyone, well, if I do that, then they're not going to want me. No, it's the dentist goes into a restaurant. They want to know, is this a hamburger or a pizza or a taco? And then once you say it, you know what it is, he doesn't want to go in the kitchen and make it. So what the dentist advice consultants like me is basically, I want to know what the recipe is. I want to know what the menu is. Mm-hmm. And then I want to pay to have you implement it. Because if you can come down here to my 55 employees and get her done, I'm paying to get it implemented.
Yes, you are.
I want to know exactly what you're doing. And all the consultants in the industry, when I'm out with a dentist and say, okay, Charlie, here's a big name brand consultant. What would they do if they come in your office? I don't know. Hey, what about this one? I don't know. And so they don't buy. And then if someone gets on there and gets transparent, builds online CE models, and they say, this is exactly how I think, exactly what I do,
then
dentists say, well, I want to order that.
Well, dentists need that clarity. Yeah. The average dentist, the mind.
So that's why I'm trying to get clarity out of you. Tell them what you would do. If they hired you, what would it cost? What do you do?
Well, she asks for their vision most of the time. I mean, and I think that's what they, mm-hmm. you know, she wants to find out what they want. And then she...
Yeah, it's sort of like, you know, I don't do cookie cutter management. Mm-mm. It really is personalized to that doctor's vision, philosophy, what they love to do, Howard.
And what did you say the four areas were?
Clinical aptitude, managerial style, financial outcome, and transition strategies. That's it. You have to look at these four things. And also the other components, this is overview, the other four modules between best practice standards that everybody wants to establish and or has, and patient care delivery, there's four areas that are vital key components: culture, people, process, and supporting technology. Those four components transform every business setting, and especially in dentistry.
Okay, so go over that. Go, just take the mic away and go over that. Because I what I really want at the end of the day is I want to help them get her done. I want my dentist. I want to get her done. So they got your name, Dentrepreneur website. Go over these. So that somebody driving to work right now might sit there and think, yeah, you're right, I need to do this.
All right, so if you have a vision, you're an entrepreneur, you're a solo dentist, whether you own 5 offices or 50 offices, your thought process is the same. The outcome of what that patient receives. That's first and foremost, because that's really the heart of why a dentist became a dentist. The fact that they have gifting to be a businessman or woman and to lead in a greater capacity is fabulous. And that really dictates the model that they want to design. So you have to look at the people. You have to have a top performance team, and we evaluate that. Are people the right person doing the right job for the right amount of money? And what we do in dentistry, most leaders, is that we think that if someone is expensive, that they're qualified to do the job, which that is not true. So we throw money at whatever element, administrative, assistant, hygiene, whatever, and they still can't bring home the bacon because there's a compromise. So you have to take the leadership and the mindset and the vision and say, okay, you're going to create a culture that's nurturing, that's positive, very much like Starbucks. Hello. That's what they're all about.
But how can you have a positive culture in a dental office when the dentist's wife doesn't want to be working there? She doesn't want to be the office manager, and the male dentist says, "No, you're going to be the office manager because obviously when you married me because you were going to be my office manager." And she doesn't want to be there, and she's got her kids in daycare, mm-hmm. and she's not happy, and she's pissed off. And all the staff says she doesn't like her job. She hates her job. And so talk to that guy.
So that guy basically is not going to get real big. Yeah. And he's a controller. Or she is. I have husbands who work at the front desk. The dentists are the practitioners.
The female. The wife.
So it could work either way.
So their vision is minimal. So what is the red flag that your spouse, whether it's a man or a woman, should not be in the office?
They should not be in the office, period.
It's a barrier.
Rule number one is do you want to work here? And if it's a woman, it's almost always tells me, hell no, I don't want to work here. I got 3 kids. Why do I want to be in a dental office?
So that's it. Why would you come in to an environment and create a toxicity of sort between the husband and wife and expect a different outcome from the culture of the employees? You set the tone. I mean, that's the responsibility you have. And you have to reinforce the vision so the culture reflects what it's supposed to be and where you want to go.
Okay, so how is this dentist going to be a leader? If the only way you get into dental school is you got to get A's in calculus and trig and physics and algebra, and we sat in a library every single night at Creighton University. That's what I heard every single night. Ding. The library will be closing in 5 minutes. So the natural selection is, let's get a bunch of freaks. I never had one date in undergrad or the first 3 years of dental school. I got accepted a year early. Wow. You know you're a loser when you get accepted to dental school a year early. No date, no car. And so you get this natural selection of math, physics, science freaks. Mm-hmm. And then someone comes along like you, all touchy-feely, saying, you got to be a leader. And you got to have this positive culture, and you got to attract and retain all these people. And he just wants to go in his private office, shut the door, and do a physics problem.
Okay, so if that's the person, then they must be surrounded with people that complement what they want to do. And you have to form what that is. And that means your team has to compensate for your shortcomings.
So would you say you have to have an office manager that compliments you?
Absolutely.
Okay, well, they all tell me, this is what they say to me. Well, I don't believe in office managers. Mm-hmm. Well, do you believe in gravity?
Okay, so they're a manager and a clinician. They're not a leader and they're not an entrepreneur. Everybody's a leader. It all depends on the capacity in which they choose to lead. So you can't make people wrong because that is their capacity. That's their limitation. And so what you do is you create a culture that supports that and still allows them to flourish because that's where they want to operate. You don't make them wrong. You nurture what they are able to digest. And that's the bottom line.
You're good. I love that. I love
that's
that.
That's what you do.
Yeah, that's good.
You know, the industry is so busy telling us, other consultants, and I won't name names, that if
this is Dentistry Uncensored.
If you don't do this, if you don't join a group practice, you will not have a place to practice. That's not true. It's not true. And so you look at what people are serving our industry and the patients, and you say, you know what? You can have whatever you want. We just need to design it so it really complements you and it serves those patients that you are going to serve. So I don't cookie cutter. I sit down and say, okay, tell me what you think you want to do.
Okay,
tell
so what would you, I'm a new client.
I'm working with you.
And I call you up.
And you're a real project, let me just tell you. You are a huge project, Howard.
I'm a retired friend and I get out of the Betty Ford Center on Tuesday.
Oh, my Lord.
My practice has been shut down for 4 months.
Where do we go from here?
Howard,
I had one of those. It wasn't you, but I had one.
It's actually 18% of dentists during their career.
I know.
We need to do some podcasts on because we've done too many on implants and too many on so many things. But 18 out of 100 dentists will go to rehab for a length of time in their career. So we need to do more than that. So back to this deal. Would you first start about culture, people, process, technology, or would you go over clinical names, finance, transition, management? Where would you start?
I do a 3-day assessment. I mean, that's the first thing I do.
You come down there for 3 days?
I live with them for 3 days. And
in the house too?
In the practice, not in the house, no. Oh. But in the practice. And in those 3 days, before I even get there, I've done a complete financial assessment to look at where they're at, what the shortcomings are, what their outcome has been, managerial, just numbers, you know.
Okay, I got a picture.
So when I go on site, now I live with you. I'm in your culture. I'm dealing with your people. I'm looking at your clinical delivery, your aptitude. How many rooms are you managing? What is the operational part of it?
But these guys listening to you, they're all alone. My whole motto was when I saw the internet, you know, I was tired of being alone. If I ever had a problem and I called anybody that loved me, you know, my mom would say a prayer. My dad would offer mass. I mean, we went to mass every day. If I said anything to my mom, she'd say a rosary. My dad would say, I'll say a novena. I just wanted to talk to a dentist. They're all alone. So this dentist listening, you said you looked at their numbers. Describe the average financial scenario of someone calling you. Like what is the average size of the practice?
A solo dentist that's doing about $1.2 million, which is average for 5 treatment rooms and should be. And it doesn't matter.
So these are bigger practices because the average practice only does $500,000. So the average person calling you is twice the average. Mm-hmm.
And they're seasoned.
That was my point earlier. Yeah. So who's your average incoming call? Oh, $1.2 million. Mm-hmm. That was my point. All the people listening doing $500,000, they should have called any consultant 5 years ago. And that was the point I made earlier.
Yes.
Everybody who's already crushing it, like me and Jerome Smith, are the ones using consultants every year. Mm-hmm. And then everyone who desperately needs it will never make the phone call.
And you know, the right consultant. I had a doctor say, how do I know which consultant really is going to be a fit for me? And he just finished a whole program with another one. I said, here's what I know. Every consultant will make an impact on you. And they'll nurture you to the next level. It's sort of like a coach. When they become ineffective and they can't take you beyond where they have taken you, it's time to change game. It's time to get somebody that's, I've been with the sparrows and now I need an eagle. Only because of capacity. No, it's like, here's my customer. When they say new dentist are 1 to 15 years out, it's usually around 10, 12, 15 years I get the call. Okay, I paid off my debt. I paid off my school loan. Now I need to make money. Now I need to say...
Don't you think it's funny they always... Everyone, all they complain about is how much student loan they debt. You know, like, I got $250,000 in student loans. And you're like, dude, your first divorce will cost $1 million. I mean, why?
I hope they're not
your student loan debt to divorce debt. Can you give them some ratio numbers of how much?
Well, I hope that. And you know, volume or the end number, the gross number, is not really real because
The gross number of the student loan or the practice?
The practice,
yeah.
You know, it's not real. Because right. by the time they look at their write-offs and all the other stuff, you know, they don't even analyze it correctly. So when I go in, I already have a picture of, here's what you need to know and understand.
Okay, so someone calls you up. Okay, so they're going to go to Entrepreneur the Deed.
Dentrepreneursolutions.com.
Okay, so then what's your number?
770-841-5721.
I saw that number at a Circle K bathroom.
Probably.
I swear to God, I can.
For a good time.
I doubt
for
that.
For a good
Howard.
Time.
So they call you up. How much is this to get?
The assessed.
Are you going to come in? Or the,
no, know? I personally go.
You personally go.
I personally go, and it's all on site. I can do a virtual assessment.
So these are different packages?
Mm-hmm. The virtual assessment is me logging in, extracting data, doing everything except visiting you. And if I go on site, it's double. So it's $7,500 for virtual, and it's $15,000 for me to be with there for 3 days. And out of the 15, I guarantee them a return of 30 in my 3 days. Treatment presentation, close the cracks on collection. I already have a plan when I walk in there. My objective is always not to be a liability, but an asset. Then I'm able to present with them, especially with my hygiene consultant, my hygiene analysis of the department, is here's what you're missing. Here's what you could develop just through your hygiene.
So these guys are already doing $1.2 million.
Yeah, about average.
They're calling you. So here's my point. Dentistry is such a small industry, you can't be a consultant in it for 5, 10, 20, 30 years, and nobody's happy with your services. The only reason these people stay in business is because the same reason people come into your office when you broke a tooth and you fix it with a crown. If you didn't help any patients, you wouldn't be in business. And so the people calling her already did 1.2. They're giving her 15,000 and you're guaranteeing they'll make 30 back. That's what all the millionaires say. That's what we all know. Mm-hmm. And what we know is that staff are complicated and all humans are complicated. All humans are batshit crazy. At 53 years old, I finally realized that I'm actually the only normal person on Earth.
Wow. Wow. I am so glad I came to see you.
You want my autograph? So since everybody is crazy, myself included, a consultant, when someone comes 100 miles away from home with a plan and a briefcase and starts paying attention to the practice, they just take notes. I mean, don't you think you can get them to listen to you and a plan far more than the existing dentist that's been in there?
Yeah,
Especially if you're asking them to change.
You know, I always say to them, okay, tell me, if you were Disney World and you were Six Flags, what's going to dictate what park you go to? I mean, what is it about your office, your team, your location that's going to have your customer say, I want to go there? What is it about brand awareness is different than brand insistence? And that's something in marketing and in cultivating what sets you apart, your distinction as a dentist, is huge. It's absolutely huge. And it needs to be mirrored by everybody that's in there.
So explain brand awareness and brand insistence.
Yeah, brand awareness is Nike. Brand insistence is just do it. Just do it. Just do it. And that's very important for a dentist. You know, everybody wants to learn cosmetic dentistry. They want to do this. They want to do that. You know, dentists have a way of sort of tracking with other dentists. Like, well, George is doing it down the street. Or Marianne has come into this office and she does it this way. I always say, tell me what you love to do. Tell me what you think your best asset is as a dentist, as a leader, as a provider. Tell me.
So you talked about clinical, and then what was this, management?
Mm-hmm.
Management. So let's talk about clinical.
Clinical aptitude.
So can a dentist be successful who only does hygiene, restorative fillings, and crowns?
Yes.
They can be $1 million practice and not do molar endo or place implants?
Yes.
Okay, and what percent of the dentists would you say calling you that have $1 million practice and are financially doing real well, never do place implants, do ortho, molar, no. They basically just do restorative dentistry.
75%.
Yeah, 75%. So there seems to be this big industry perception that if you're not going to buy a $100,000 CBCT and a $150,000. How many of these million-dollar practices did not buy a $150,000 CAD cam?
Almost all the ones I work with.
I know. So why? So the biggest stressful question to these kids out of school is, I have $250,000 in debt. Now you're telling me to buy a $150,000 Sharrock CAD cam. It's like, I don't know a single guy collecting a million, taking home $400,000 has one. But no. You think you have to have this magic bullet for 100.
Yeah, you're better apt to go in, and when I utilize Kim, I bring her in, and I allow them to see the value of education and awareness of their health. Take responsibility for your health.
Of the dentist's health?
Of the patient's health. Of the patient. Okay. So through hygiene is where you're going to really connect with that patient.
Okay, I'm going to ask you another specific. What percent of the time... you know, we see this phenomenon in the United States where 117 metros have about 60% of the dentist, and the 19,000 and 22 towns in the rural have about a 40%. So you see things like Heartland, who was, you know, they were just going to towns of 2,000-3,000 and never had a dentist. Walmart was in 30 states before it went into a major metro. So how many times do you go in there and you're like, dude, there's a dentist for every 300 people. You need to move. I mean, how big of a demographics are, can you usually go in there and work no matter what the demographics is or existing? Or do you ever get there and say, you know, you need to move?
Well, it's funny. South Georgia, I did a incubation of a mastermind group 2 years ago. I was sort of checking things out. How could I better serve these gentlemen and women who want to lead, who want to have small offices? So South Georgia, I had this gentleman contact me. He came. He said, I'm looking for an associate. And he was in the middle of nowhere. I said, really? He says, yes. I said, well, you know, there's not many grads coming out of MCG, coming back into your area.
Somewhat MCG.
Oh, I'm sorry. A Medical College of Georgia. And that's the dental school in Georgia. And I said, I think your best associate may be another dentist closest to you that may want to merge with you and collaborate with you, especially if he's younger. And he was probably in his late 60s. And a lot of these areas, Howard, they just die off. I mean, there is no young dentist coming to these areas. Everybody wants to be in the metro areas where the competition is off the chain. And it's very hard to buy a practice and make it successful the second time. But the third time, it's almost impossible. Wouldn't you say?
Yeah, it's always going to be tough because, I saw in Kansas City where, you know, all these kids came from small farm towns in Kansas, Missouri, North and South Dakota. And you come to Kansas City and it's got the Royals and the Chiefs and the Plaza and all these fine restaurants and shopping. And it's like, you can't leave that and go back to Salina. So all the money's made in Salina. But here's the rub. Most of the dentists are in the suburb and they have an hour commute to downtown. And most of them in the suburb, if they had an hour commute out of town, they would be driving to a town of 2,500 with no dentist. And that's what the demographics people, that's what the corporates, that's what they're all finding. Mm-hmm. Everyone listening to my podcast is driving from lower dentists per thousand to more dentists per thousand. And if they turn around and make that same commute on the other way out of town, I mean, it would just be amazing. In fact, there was this one guy, very good friend of mine, who actually bought a $100,000 plane. And he actually lived right up the street where there's a housing addition that has a runway. What's that called, Ryan? That the housing addition up the street built on a runway in Chandler, Arizona. And he would just get up every morning and he would just ride in his driveway just roll out his plane and fly 2 hours.
That's, you know, the creative part. Really? See, that's the creative
and
mind.
Just crushed it. Mm-hmm.
That's the creative mind that you say, what do we do? I say, I design dreams for dentists that really want to do something different. That's the bottom line. And I promise a return. I even started an inner circle, all access. So a dentist can be a part for a whole year, $1,200 a month, be on personal calls. I'll help develop their vision, their platforms they want, coach them, group calls, and an annual event, destination event, that they get to and bring in guest entrepreneurs from every aspect of life. I had a billionaire be my mentor for 6 years, Dr. Nito Quibin, who started out as a consultant speaker. He leveraged his success Now serves on the board of BB&T, Lazy Boy. He chairs Great Harvest Bread Company. He currently is the president of High Point University. He took that university from a failing institution in 8 months, raised $48 million, leveraged it into one of the top 30 private colleges in this country, according to Forbes, in less than 10 years.
Now, that is amazing.
Now, when you have people like that influencing you, the responsibility is to then take that and influence in your sphere of influence, which for me, it's dentist.
So you're seeing clinical, that's not the issue. If you want to refer endo and not do implants, that's not the issue.
No.
So then next, and so what is it when you're going over clinical? What is the issue for these four things?
Well, you look at what their clinical limitation is and what they've studied and what they like to do. I mean, a lot of doctors, they're CE nuts. I mean, they have gone to these courses, whether it's Pankey, Dawson, Coy, Spear, whatever it is, and they've never integrated and penetrated the soul of their practice with that mindset. Do you understand that? Yeah. They've spent hundreds of thousands of dollars, and they keep it like right here, and their team never really understands the
The only thing I remember from Coy's, who's a good friend of yours, he's 100% Greek. He just sprays everything with Windex.
What?
Didn't you see the movie My Big Fat Greek Wedding? Remember the grandpa sprayed everything?
Okay. Yeah. So that's what I refer. Management is, you know, is there an infrastructure? Are you flying by the seat of your pants? Are you personally managing? Or have you created self-led individuals that really bring the bacon to the table for you and inform you?
So here's your deal. All social animals, all apes, monkeys, dogs, cats, they all have a 400-pound grill, and we all have to work together as a team. Yeah. And so what got us here was we work together as a team. So the 400-pound gorilla wants to control the whole tribe, and he won't delegate anything. Mm-hmm. And you say, okay, you're going nowhere, and you won't let your hygienist read an x-ray because she's diagnosing, even though no hygienist has ever gone to jail ever. Since the beginning of, you know, since Jesus, that, you know, from diagnosing, you won't let the assistants talk. You won't show any of the numbers. There's no transparency. After every patient, you walk back in the room and you close your door. So how do you, I mean, the guy's a freak. How do you get a controlling?
Well, it could be a guy or a girl leading. Yeah. Okay.
Controlling. I mean, an ape is hardwired at birth to control, and she's the 400-pound gorilla. And now you're telling her that she should only weigh 200 and make her receptionist weigh 300 and let her hygienist talk to patients and let her assistant talk to the shine rep. And so how do you,
well,
I guess my point is this. If I was going to trade jobs with you and I was going to go from clinical dentistry to consulting, I'd go hire Dr. Phil. I mean, I wouldn't even.
Well, I'm sort of a Dr. Phil.
You know, if someone wanted me to consult their office, I would first send in a psychologist and a therapist. Yeah. And because I think when they would figure out their issues, then they and just become normal. If they just became normal
it is about
and delegate and a happy culture and no dysfunction.
But it is about the brain. I mean, I have a little bit of experience in that. And I feel that's part of my gifting is that the frontal lobe is, you know, where we want to be, but the back part of our brain is where our fear lives. And when we're fearful of letting go, we're fearful because we, A, don't believe that we have the right people in the right place to let go with. And the model in which we are operating in is an old mindset. So if you can't shift your brain into, okay, I want to be creative and innovative. I want to find the right people that can opt into what I believe. And how am I going to train them up? So there's a book, a great book. It's called Tribal Leadership. And I created a whole program on how to put this mindset in a dental practice.
Okay, so I'm going to ask you, when you go into an office, what percent of the time do they have the right people in there they just need to be developed versus what percent of the time do you walk in there and say, those three monkeys got to go?
I would say change upon me entering that culture, maybe like 60% we need to change. Here's what I've discovered,
so
Howard.
Changing one or more?
One.
Just
one. One or two.
60,
one or two.
So 6 in 10 times, somebody's got to go.
Mm-hmm. One or
and
two.
Why does the dentist not see that?
Fear that change is going to disrupt, and they don't like disruption.
And I always say, people either have, they're willing to learn and they haven't been trained, or they're not willing to change. And here's Dr. Nita Quibian's famous, Rhonda, either the people change or you change the people. And that's the bottom line. That is management across the board.
So I'm going to throw, I already know what they're all yelling in their car while you're saying, they're going to say, oh, Howard, you live in Phoenix with 3.9 million people and you're talking to Rhonda and she's in Atlanta with 3 million people. I'm in Bumblebutt, Parsons, Kansas, population of 4,000 bucks. And my assistant only has one eye, but, you know, she's the only one that had an eye. I mean, they're
But saying, she has the right attitude.
So what are you saying to the people in small rural America? Can you find the best people?
You know what I've done? You know, I have served rural Tennessee since 1990. I've served rural Georgia numerous times, Northeast, rural area in Connecticut. If you have the right person with the right attitude, and a lot of banking background individuals are fabulous in dental offices, and I've trained them on dentistry. Dentistry's redundant. If they know managerial, they're great administrative. If they're technically gifted, they're great assistants. So, you know, that's sort of my take on it. I've taken people with no background and trained them up. They've been the best employees in those small areas.
I agree. I think the best people for business is the bookkeepers, and they're all asking for 25% less than anybody who works in dentistry at any position, and the bank tellers. And the two best employees I ever got was the lady doing my deposit at Chase and a bookkeeper. Because you can take a bookkeeper and teach them dentistry in a few months. But there's a lot of people in dentistry that could never learn how to balance their check register.
That's right.
And they've been working at this desk for 5 years on Dentrix, and you say, run me this financial report. You've been sitting at the desk for 5 years, run that report, and they go, oh, well, he never showed me how to do that. Well, who showed you how to run your iPhone? You just gave a shit enough to figure out how it all works. But when he's paying you money and you're sitting on Dentrix for 5 years, you never had any gumption go figure out anything. And then you blame it that the doctor didn't train you or take you to a staff to train you.
That's,
but all this stuff you figured
that's
out.
That's the biggest thing. If you're in a tribe, you have a responsibility with other people in the tribe. If you're a level 5, you have a responsibility to nurture those people up to your level so everybody's on the same platform to serve in a greater capacity with a greater momentum. And when that happens, the dentist is leading from the bottom of the pack, and they love it. They absolutely love it. And you can serve more people, and you can make a bigger impact. And the hygienists are a key element to that. That's why I brought Kim in. After 25 years of knowing her, trained her in a huge capacity beyond what she brought to the table, which was fabulous as far as perio care, and really said, you know what? What would you do beyond the norm? And the norm was educate. And then bring in another enhancement. And that's what I love. You know, this laser service that she teaches in and trains in, Texas just adopted it. Mm-hmm. And that is huge in our country. And I think that that's another way of providing care.
So you're talking about the laser. You're talking about the perio laser?
The diode laser.
The diode laser.
Yeah, there's several different diode lasers. And I started using 06 in perio treatment. And I was a little iffy because I'd worked for a periodontist for like 7 years. So I was like, and then there's still a lot of, you know, that laser stuff. We don't know if it works, does it work, whatever. Personally, I see a huge difference in my patients when I use the laser. So I truly believe in the laser. I truly believe that's another service that a hygienist can use to get their patients healthy again. And I find that I go in a lot of offices and hygienists, all they're doing is prophies all day long. I mean, I'm sure you've heard that and you see that. Prophy. I go in and first patient I see, I need to do perio on. I go tell the doctor, and the doctor's like, oh, we've just been watching, you know, it's okay, just do a prophy. And I see that all the time. And so for me, that's what got me so excited and involved. I thought, you know, somebody needs to go in here and actually talk to these hygienists so that they are better educating their patients, because our overall health now, diabetes, high blood pressure, all that stuff is so important. And when you get to the patient that way, when I look in their chart, I'm like, you know, how's your HbA1c level? Have you had that checked lately if they're diabetic? And they can tell me. And if you do perio treatment on these patients and take care of them, I think if you educate them through that way, they're more apt to listen and accept treatment, because so many patients don't want to hear that they've got gum disease and you need to treat it. Because I've talked to patients, when I finished educating them, they're like, no one's ever told me that before. Now, they've been seeing the same hygienist and been at the same dentist for 20 years. And I don't understand that. I don't understand when a patient looks at me and says, nobody's ever told me that before. I actually, you know, let's do this. Let's get this done. And to me, that makes my day.
See, teaching people how to communicate and deliver bad news well is a really effective leader.
Excuse me, you have an interproximal lesion on the distal surface number 3 causing irreversible pulpitis. We'll need to do endodontic therapy, a post buildup, and a full coverage restoration. Do you have any questions? Any questions?
Yeah. What did you just say?
I mean, here's the thing.
When that patient said that no one's ever told her she has gum disease, they told her every time. They told her in Latin and Greek.
You have periodontal disease.
You have
when I worked point. For the periodontist, which was years ago, we had a phase contrast microscope. So one of the things that we did,
so cool.
We would go in a pocket, we'd take the plaque, we'd put it on a microscope slide. I would put it on that microscope, it would come up on a TV screen, and those patients would be like, oh my gosh.
Why did that go away in dentistry?
It was the best motivational tool. But I tell Reed, patients
Perry,
that. And
Omar
they go, what?
Reed and Perry Radcliffe. Remember those two? They showed me that, that 30 years ago.
It was the 90s.
And they
early
would
90s.
Show that and the Late patients. 80s. Because what, you know, from the mouth 30 feet down out the back door anus is 12,000 different species of
bacteria,
fungi, and viruses. Yep. So you go to the San Diego Zoo. And there's 4,600 species there. And inside her mouth, inside that gut biome,
there's
is 12,000 species.
There's
a
disconnect.
And when Omar Reed and Perry Radcliffe would do that and put those bugs on the deal and they would show that. And, you know, humans are visual animals.
Oh, yes.
Birds are audio. And apes are visual. And when those patients would see that, they would just like, wow. And then they were selling... Retardex, a chlorine dioxide, which is kind of another type. What was the other one? The multi-level marketing.
Oxyfresh.
And those, Omar Reed and Perry Radcliffe, they could sell anything to anybody because they were just so gifted with communication. And that phase microscope, I've thought 1,000 times.
It's awesome.
You know, why doesn't that come back to dentistry? Why doesn't somebody make a low-cost microscope? Because when the bottom line, here's the bottom line. Those bugs, you know, when a baby is born and it has no teeth, there's no environment for an anaerobic bacteria to live. And it's not until a tooth pops through with some tissue laying over it that those bugs, those anaerobes can live.
Yep.
And what's so funny is, look at these books here. These are 100-year-old dental books. And when you read 100-year-old dental books by guys, and by, these are $1,000.
Oh my goodness.
These are $10,000 books by G.B. Black and these guys. 100 years ago, they were noticing that if you would go to a person and you would pull all their teeth, they would massively get better.
Oh,
their
yeah.
jaundice would go away.
Oh, yeah.
The color of their eyes would come back. Their health would be restored. And there was a movement a century ago that if I really want to do you good, I need to get all your teeth out and get rid of all that pyorrhea and infection, that sea of infection. And here it is 100 years later, and you're trying to talk about the oral health connection, and people are talking like it's some new thing, that the mouth might be connected to your liver and Alzheimer's. And every 3 months, they discover a new species of bacteria just in dental decay, not the mouth, just in the cavity.
The cavity itself.
And every single disease they're looking at, I mean, not every single disease, but every single organ has at least one disease where they're finding anaerobic bacteria in there. And the only place they find anaerobic bacteria is when a tooth pops through the mouth and you don't have that. Look at gum disease. You pull all the teeth and the gums heal up in 24 hours.
Yep.
And so everything we're talking about,
it's old.
It was 100 years ago.
Well, we're talking about the care of an individual. So why would we not want to operationally have everything in place to serve them, so their fear and their comfort and their trust level was huge to serve them in that capacity and ultimately staying in business so that we can continue to serve them? That's what we do. wrap it all together.
I very, very seldom have a patient, and this is a patient that I'm working as a temporary hygienist in. They've never seen me before, and they're wondering where Ashley is because Ashley's so fabulous, and they want only Ashley to clean their teeth. And I get done with them, and most of the time they're like, are you going to be here when I get back? Or they'll say, if I've recommended perio treatment, I almost always have someone compliant with whatever I've, you know, diagnosed, or not diagnosed, but did a treatment plan for, or whatever. It's but it's the way you speak to them, it's the way you talk to them.
Can I say my thoughts on the laser, on the laser surgery?
Yeah, sure. I get a lot of different.
I think you can't be dentist focused. You know, dentists, I say, are you focused on the patient or the dentist? They say, oh, I'm totally focused on the patient. Okay, what are your hours? Monday through Thursday, right. 8 to 4. Okay, yeah. So are you just not right in the head, or you know, did you have a head injury, or did you drop acid before I asked you that question? I mean, they're crazy. But the deal is you need to be patient-focused, not dentist. I don't care what the dentist thinks, that if he thinks that film x-ray is better than digital x-ray. Mm-hmm. The fact that on digital x-ray, I can blow it up on an 8x10 sheet of paper and give it to the patient is why we're going digital x-ray. Mm-hmm. And I don't want to hear about the arguments of film, because I personally preferred film on a view box a lot better. I think it was a lot clearer, a lot better. I loved it, but I gave it up for the patient. If a laser makes grandpa's eyes get big and makes him get focused on his teeth and makes him start brushing, flossing, and coming in, if whatever makes you motivated, it's like cardiologists, cardiovascular surgeons, whatever's going to make you quit smoking, lose weight, and start running a 5K, I'm all into it. Right. You know, I don't care what that takes. Okay. And if doing it with a laser, I got podiatrist friends that say, my God, when I do foot surgery, I can take a 15 blade, make that slit in a second, pull out my handpiece, knock that corn off in a minute, so it'll be done. But no one wants that. Mm-hmm. So I advertise laser. Now I'm like there dinking around for 15 minutes with a stupid laser trying to make this hamburger cut. Takes me 3 times longer. In fact, half the time I just cheat. If she's put out of sleep, I don't even get the laser out. I just slice it open, do it in 3 minutes. But if having a laser makes grandma get her foot fixed, then a laser is what a doctor needs to get, because grandma couldn't walk on her foot and it took a laser to get her to come in there and submit to having it done.
They want to be able to serve in a capacity that really gets the outcome. And I always say, that's all well and good, but you got to start with you. You got to start with how you think, how you operate, how you communicate. I do on-site coaching. I mean, I literally send the doctor in or the hygienist in, listen to how they present treatment and or educate, pull them out and say, okay, now I want you to go back in there and I want you to say it this way. So then they go back in, they say it my way. Then they come back out and I say, okay, that's pretty good. Now, when you go back in again, here's what you're going to say. See, it's behavioral. We learn by experience. 80% retention by direct, purposeful experiences.
I've never met an Olympic athlete get a gold medal without a coach. I never met anybody who's good at anything without a coach. And all I'm saying is that the dentists that are humble and realize that consultants are a return investment, they can bring in someone like yourself and can be humble enough to listen. Everyone else wants to think, I'm perfect, I know everything. Mm-hmm. And it's the humble ones that say, hey, Rhonda, if I give you a buck, do you think you can come down here and make me two? And they're coachable. And I would say 28 years of watching dentists is the ones who got the farthest are the ones that are most humble, which means they listen to their staff, means they listen to their patients, means they listen to consultants. I've always had consultants. Jan, my assistant 20 years, has chewed me out more times than my ex-wife. My team, we run a democracy. I mean, when we vote, I mean, there's 5 people. If 3 people say we're doing this, we're going that way, and 2 say going that way, it doesn't matter that on my 5th vote, I own the company. I run a democracy, because I think to myself, if I can't convince the 4 other women that have been with me 20, 30 years, then I need to go back and work on my arguments. I need to go back and work on what I'm thinking. I need to give it more time. But
and you know, that's what I really pride myself on. If I meet with someone and they're not ready for my level of participation, I'll give them strategy and I'll direct them to where they're at to be able to do what they need to do. And that way you're still serving them and preparation for a greater level.
And in your career, how many times did they tell you their situation and you just took them to a vet and had them put down?
Never. There's always hope.
Oh, there's always hope,
hope, Howard.
Oh,
there's always spoken, hope.
Spoken like a true.
So thank you.
A true woman from the South.
No, well, I'm not from the South. I'm from Pittsburgh, really.
Really? You're from Pittsburgh? I always thought you were from
No, that's just where I fly in and out of. Oh, of course. Oh my
God, I'm a Chargers
of
fan.
Of course. No, yes. Yes.
Well,
yes.
Rhonda, thank you for coming by and spending an hour and a half with me today. And Kim Pinzini.
Yes.
So the name Tortellini was already taken, or
don't know.
You know, I come on. It's your husband's Italian name.
I'm a Southern Italian.
A Southern Italian. But ladies, thank you so much for coming by and sharing what you know. And hopefully some of those listeners out there will sit there and be humble and get help and say, I trust that if I give these guys a buck, I'll make two back. And they will. Yep. And I've been a big fan of yours for literally 3 decades. So thank you for all that you do for dentistry.
Thank you.
And nice to see you again.